I also thank the organizers for that opportunity to present our results here. And with the next slide, I would love to give my special thanks to my old friend, in a good sense, old friend, Professor Ion Tigignano. Sorry?
Who are these two young guys?
Yeah, that's the point. So we have studied together with Ion Tigignano long ago together in the Moscow Physical Engineering Institute. We spent few years in the students' dormitory, not only studying physics, but also playing football in the rain in front of the dormitory. Finally, in 1978, got our diploma that were given to us by academician, Nobel Prize winner, Professor Academician Basov, Nikolai Basov. So that's a very short historical excursion, and thanks God that now we are still in business together with my old friend Ion Tigignano. Thank you for this invitation to this conference and for the possibility to give this plenary talk. Here is the layout. First, I will spend a couple of slides only about the instrumentation that allows performing Terahertz spectroscopic experiments. I will finish with a short conclusion, and in between, I will give just flash very briefly without any details, so just representative results about what we got on several, on a number of materials. This will be graphene, as you see here, carbon nanotubes, and the fullerenes, nano water with its ferroelectricity, magnetic nanoclusters, aerogel materials, and water, nano-confined water in biological systems. I would like to apologize in advance, since I will be speaking about so strongly different materials in my presentation, but I have several excuses for that. The first one is that I will show you that Terahertz spectroscopy is not only effective, but also a universal tool that allows to study very different materials. Secondly, I believe that in the audience, there are representatives from the community, from magnetic community, ferroelectric community, CNT community, and other community, water community, bio communities. And hopefully they will find some parts of my presentation that will be interesting to them. And finally, when one studies with certain technique, very different materials, one has a possibility to somehow get impression about general behavior in those different materials. I mean, the behavior, the generalities in physical properties, and maybe one has also a possibility to draw some general conclusions about the properties of those materials, maybe general, maybe even philosophical, that can allow to draw some really very general impressions about the physical properties of condensed matter. So these are my excuses. I will speak about these several materials here. The results are obtained in collaboration with many groups from all over the world. They are listed here from Russia, of course, Finland, as you see here, from Germany, Japan, UK, and of course from Moldova, with whom we also did some joint investigations. So just a couple of slides about the equipment that allows to perform spectroscopy in the terahertz range, which is specified in this frequency interval, approximately from 0.1 terahertz up to approximately 10 terahertz. So this is the terahertz range. And there are three main spectrometers that are used for the experiments in this range. These are listed here, the coherent source, so-called frequency domain spectrometer, the pulsed time domain spectrometer, and the traditional Fourier transform spectrometers. Just a few slides about that. So this is about the coherent source spectrometer, spectroscopy. It is based on these unique sources of radiation, terahertz radiation, that can give, they basically generate the radiation that is monochromatic, coherent, and its frequency can be finely tuned just by changing the supplying high voltage. So these sources of radiation, these are backward wave oscillators. They cover the frequency range from approximately 0.03 terahertz up to 1.5 or even 2 terahertz. They allow for direct measurements of any basically characteristic of any material, as shown here, just a couple of examples. For the dielectric material, one can measure the spectra of real and imaginary permittivity. So a couple of examples are shown here. So these are the absorption lines and corresponding dispersion in epsilon prime, real part of permittivity of this ferroelectric material. Also, one can measure the magnetic resonances as shown here for the manganese 12 magnetic cluster. I will speak about it today a little bit later. So these are the real and imaginary parts of magnetic permeability. You can see that these are the resonances. I will speak about them a little bit later. So these are the possibilities of the coherent source backward wave oscillator spectroscopy. Another nice technique is the pulsed time domain spectrometer. That is based on the fact that the picosecond pulse interacts with a sample and then is detected by a semiconductor antenna. And the information about the properties of the sample is obtained by Fourier transformation, Fourier analysis of the pulse that passed in transmission mode through the sample. And of course, the traditional spectroscopy, Fourier transform spectroscopy, that is basically an infrared technique, but with its low frequency wing, low frequency part, it covers also the terahertz range. It is based on the Michelson interferometer. Everybody knows about how it works. And finally, one can measure with this technique the reflection coefficient of the samples or the transmission coefficient of the samples. So we are doing this spectroscopy in our lab at Moscow Institute of Physics and Technology. These are very briefly our spectrometers, the coherent source spectrometer, two time domain spectrometers, Fourier transform spectrometer. And in addition, we are also using the radio frequency spectrometer, which is shown here. It allows for measurements of the properties of the samples in the range of frequencies from subhertz up to several megahertz. So with all this equipment, we can measure a very broad spectral response for basically any kind of material. So I start my review with the nanocarbon materials that can be zero dimensional or like fullerenes or one dimensional like CNTs, carbon nanotubes, two dimensional graphene, or they can be also three dimensional nanostructures. There is no need to say that these guys, these materials find lots of applications that range from electronics to biology and medicine. And they also reveal rich fundamental interesting properties that are very actively studied. So graphene, everybody knows what this is. Normally it is grown on copper foils. And here I show the standard procedure, how the graphene can be transferred from the copper foil to any other substrate. And that's important for terahertz measurements since copper is not transparent for terahertz radiation. But at the same time, all the measurements are done in transmission mode as shown here in terahertz range. Here the graphene was transferred to the silicon transparent substrate. Here one measures the transmission coefficient versus frequency due to interference of radiation within substrate. One gets these interference fringes in the transmission coefficient. Although these spectra look very trivial, but their analysis, they allow to get very important fundamental information about the charge carriers in graphene, like the conductance versus frequency and temperature or the scattering rate of charge carriers in graphene, as shown here. If one rolls graphene, one gets carbon nanotubes. A nice introduction was given yesterday by Professor Mimura about carbon nanotubes and also about the very exciting applications, not of single carbon nanotubes, but of as they call them, wafer scale films of carbon nanotubes that is shown here. These are actually several centimeters large films with a thickness of about or even less than 100 nanometers, as shown here. This is a photo of our actual sample. We simply glue these films on the metal ring. And this film, as seen here, is 1 centimeter large, but the thickness is really 80 or 100 nanometers only. And then we measure in transmission mode the dielectric, the terahertz properties of those films. Yeah, this is a Kelvin probe image of this film. It contains, of course, lots of these bundles of CNTs, several CNTs. These are the first results. First, what we found is that in terahertz range, the electrodynamics of these macroscale films is determined, is metal-like, actually. The conductivity is Drude-like. Drude means it can be described by Drude conductivity model, which is a textbook example of metallic properties. And the same with the dielectric permittivity. So both are Drude-like in the films whose quality is very good. If the quality of films gets worse, then one sees the decrease of conductivity, increase of permittivity, and one gets the so-called terahertz conductivity peak, which has been under intensive discussions for many years. Another issue is that, what I would like to stress here is that by doing this very simple experiments, just by measuring what, by letting terahertz radiation on the sample and then measuring what comes through, one can obtain a very fundamental information about the charge carriers in those films, as shown here. So here we show the temperature dependence in the broad temperature range from liquid helium up to the room temperatures, room temperature of the plasma frequency of charge carriers, their scattering rate, their mobility, mean free path, and scattering time. Again, in such a simple geometry of experiments for the measurements. One can obtain, of course, as shown here, some technical characteristics like the absorption coefficient or effective skin depth, surface resistant reactants, and real imaginary parts of refractive index, or the shielding effectiveness as shown here. So these films can be used as effective shields for the radiation of up to 1 terahertz. It's not always bad to worsen the quality of those films by, for example, making the carbon nanotubes shorter within the film or by irradiating with a plasma, in this case, oxygen plasma, those films. So both these procedures, they lead to the decrease of conductivity, of course, here and here. But at the same time, one has a possibility to enhance an important characteristic of those films, that is the temperature coefficient of resistance. This is shown here. By shortening the length of CNTs within the film, one observes huge increase of the this coefficient. And also the same happens if one exposes these films to the plasma. One again observes this strong increase of this important technical parameter of those films. Next, fullerenes. These are zero-dimensional carbon structures, nanostructures that are interesting by themselves. But also they are extremely exciting because they can be used as containers due to so-called molecular surgery. Using some procedures, one can open fullerene, separate fullerene, put in some molecule inside, like water molecule in this case, then close it again. And finally, one has this encapsulated molecule, like water molecule or another ion within fullerene, and one can study single particle or collective effects in the array of those endofullerenes. First, I will show you some fresh results about what happens if we, in terahertz range, if you put inside the lithium ion. Since lithium is very small, it can travel within the fullerene, and then facing hexagon or pentagons of the carbon nanocage, it can experience these local minima, and then depending on the temperature, the lithium ion can either fly above those minima or at low temperatures it can be localized within minima. hop between the minima or even tunnel between those minima. So what we have obtained with our spectroscopy is shown here. So this is actually the imaginary part of permittivity. This is the absorption coefficient versus frequency. The Terahertz range is here. One can see that there are very, very many absorption lines. And as usual, of course, the most important and interesting what is happening, it happens at Terahertz range. This is shown here also. We have observed the so-called soft mode, absorption mode. So the red color is for the room temperature peak, absorption peak, and then while cooling down, it moves down in frequency, and also its intensity decreases while cooling. Another interesting effect we have seen, it is shown here, when we replace 6 lithium for 7 lithium ion, then we observe nice isotopic shifts on some of those absorption lines. Yeah, all these results are under analysis, and they are very fresh, just obtained something like yesterday. Next, endofullerene is a water molecule within C60 fullerene. Here we had several possibilities what to study, interesting effects. One phenomenon is the so-called spin conversion of water molecules. It's known that water molecule can have protons that are aligned in parallel. This is the ortho modification of molecule or para molecule, when the proton spins are oppositely aligned. The mechanism of this conversion is not known in all details, and we decided to also to shed some light what was possible without Terahertz spectroscopy. The idea is shown here. These are the energy levels, rotational energy levels of ortho molecule and para water molecule. So what one can do, one can, yeah, and of course, as I said, as usual, these energies are in the Terahertz range. What one can do, one can cool down and then trace the intensity of these ortho transitions and para transitions. That's what we have done. This is shown here. So we traced the intensity of this transition of para molecules and of this transition of ortho molecules. The results are shown here. So while cooling down from below 70 Kelvin down to liquid helium temperatures, the intensity of this transition increases permanently, while the intensity of this transition of ortho molecules first increases due to Boltzmann thermalization, and then due to ortho-para conversion, it decreases strongly. Another way how to study this transformation is to quickly cool down the sample down to some temperature and get inversion of population of ortho molecules, and then wait and watch with the time the intensities of these ortho transitions and para transitions. That's what we have also done. So here we cooled down to 6 kelvins and then waited for 10 hours. This is the time axis, and as you see here nicely, the intensity of these two ortho transitions falls down with time, while the intensity of the para transition increases permanently. What we can learn from here, it's also under analysis. Obviously, this behavior in time and with temperature is obvious, but the point is that the functional dependencies can bring some microscopic information about the ortho-para conversion process, and that's under analysis, as I said. Then we come to the three-dimensional structures. This we have with the dielectric matrices, where the crystal lattice has nano cages, where one can have water molecules. I have spoken about these effects, what we have obtained on these structures during last conference. We had a possibility to touch the mystery of so-called water ferroelectricity. It's really very exciting phenomena. In liquid water, one is not able to observe. The point is that water molecule is strongly polar. And so that if you place these water molecules one close to another, one could expect ordering or water ferroelectricity, but it's not observed in liquid water due to H bonds. And that's why one has to take the water molecules far apart and then try to observe the water ferroelectricity. That's what we have obtained. As I said, I have discussed this in details during the previous conference. And we have observed the ferroelectric Curie-Weiss behavior of the permittivity and the ferroelectric soft mode. But we didn't see in beryl, in the crystal of beryl, the real phase transition. We didn't see this ferroelectric anomaly due to the suppression of phase transition due to quantum tunneling or the dipole moment of quantum molecules. But we did observe the ferroelectric transition in another crystal of cordierite where the localizing potential is strongly asymmetric. So here we have observed the soft mode behavior in the radio frequency range and the typical V-shaped dependence, temperature dependence of the frequency of this soft mode. And the order, the ground state order is shown here. So we have observed, we have analyzed the data and we have seen that there is a ferroelectric alignment of water dipole moments within the AB planes and antiferroelectric alignment along the C axis, perpendicular axis. More details about the ground state of those materials will be given tomorrow by our co-worker Belyanchikov in his presentation. Next, I want to switch briefly to the molecular nanoclusters, magnetic nanoclusters. These are materials that have macromolecules with their magnetic ions. In this case, these are iron 8 iron ions with spins up and spins down, so that the total spin equals 10. And what we studied here, we did study the transition of the ground state S10 multiplet split by the crystal field. So these are the transitions. They are seen very nicely in the transmission coefficient spectra. These are the D minima. And when one cools down, then some of this transition absorption disappears, some of those get stronger as shown here. And all this is due to the Boltzmann factor that determines the population of these energy levels. One also has a possibility to study relaxation, magnetic relaxation phenomena. This we did on another magnetic cluster material, manganese 12. That's the macromolecule that has 12 manganese ions, again, spins up, spins down, total spin 10. What we did here is that we first, at high temperature, we polarized the material with a magnetic external magnetic field. We populated this energy level, then we quickly, then we cooled down, quickly reversed the magnetic field. We have inversion population of spins that are at this, on this energy level, and we fix the temperature and weight. And of course, they want to relax to the lower energy level so that the absorption due to this transition should decrease with time and the absorption due to this transition should increase with time. That's what we did observe. This is shown here. That's, we just started waiting. This is the absorption line in the transmission coefficient spectrum. And then after waiting, this line disappears and the other line grows up here. So this is the relaxation, which we also did analyze and published the results in these papers. It's not only to play around with this transmission coefficient and these absorption lines, but this simple and at the first glance trivial spectra, they allow to get very fundamental information about the magnetic material, like the coefficients in the magnetic Hamiltonian as shown here. Next are these aerogel materials. We did some experiments together with two professors, Ion Tiginiano and Rainer Adelung. They gave very nice introduction about these materials yesterday in their lectures about the amazing properties. Just imagine enormous porosity, 99.99. These materials are built of these tetrapods, the guys that have four legs, and each leg has a wall of thickness of just 50 to 100 nanometers, so thin. And that's the reason, extremely high porosity of these materials. Okay, I see. Mm-hmm. 5 minutes. So this is a regular result of our measurements. We measure the spectra of dielectric permittivity and any other parameter, electrodynamic parameter. What we found first on the gallium nitride aero material is that in the very broad temperature interval from helium up to room temperature, the spectra are not depending, are not changing with the temperature. That's really amazing. So having this spectra, one can calculate the shielding effectiveness of those materials. It's rather high at terahertz frequencies. And since it is not depending on the temperature, for example, it can be used for some aerospace applications where it's really cold. Another aero material is gallium-203. Is different to the gallium nitride, which has very low transmission coefficient. This material, this oxide, is very transparent. So the transmission coefficient is nearly 100%. And this allows to use this as cover, protecting cover that is transparent for terahertz and also infrared radiation in some applications. Yeah, I'm close to finish. About the nano water in biological systems, you can really find this nano confined water in membranes, in channels in those membranes, in hydration shells, in other biosystems. Some results will be given today by our student Gakaeva, Zarina Gakaeva, and also tomorrow by another student, Pavel Abramov. I just want to briefly show that our very first experience with applying the terahertz spectroscopy to the biological materials. So we have studied these three substances, and immediately we found in these materials four universal behaviors that are very well known in the condensed matter physical community. The first is one is the so-called universal dielectric response, which is given by this universal expression, so-called Jonscher expression. The second one is the so-called, again, nearly constant losses. Over many orders of magnitude in frequency, the losses, which are epsilon double prime, they are frequency independent, nearly constant. The third is the scaling behavior of some combination of the AC-DC conductivity versus some combination of frequency, temperature, and conductivity, when they all fall in single master curve. And the fourth universality is the so-called boson peak in the density of states, which we also have observed in these three biological materials. With that, I can conclude. I hope I really demonstrated to you that terahertz spectroscopy can help very much to study new physical phenomena in the nanophysical materials, nanomaterials, and also help to find some applications for those materials. We are doing that at our laboratory, terahertz laboratory of terahertz spectroscopy. We are always open for collaborations, as shown here with this couple of photos. We have rich collaborations, and that's the contact information which you can also find in the materials of the conference. I hope I was in time. Thank you for your listening and for your attention.
Thank you very much, Professor Gorshunov, for your excellent presentation of such a broad spectrum of phenomena and applications that I hope that in the remaining 2 minutes, there will be a few questions. So please, who wants to formulate a question? Yes, please, Professor Magyarevich.
Thank you very much for your very nice presentation. My question would be directed into the time to market from all these interesting research results that you have mentioned now. Namely, in the biomedical instrumentation world, the more macroscopic one, like 20 years ago, time to market from research results to an instrument that finished on the market was considered to be about 15 years. Today, we speak about 7 to 10 years. During this era of the pandemics, the FDA and the European agencies introduced some fast tracks in order to make some biomedical products to reach the market, let's say, in time or very quickly. So from your point of view, from all these interesting material-based research results, how much do you think that something that you find and would be applicable in the biomedical engineering area would take to bring to the market? Thank you.
Yeah, basically all these biological materials, they are composed by, let's say, heavy molecules that can vibrate or move rather slowly. And this is the reason that these collective motions are falling into the terahertz range. And this is very well known. This is not only we that who have studied the biological materials. Really, there are many biomaterials that have these absorption lines in the terahertz range. Plus to that, what we have found, maybe this was not so well known in the bio or biophysical community, that studying the materials in the terahertz and especially in the subterahertz range, one can very clearly see the contribution, spectral contribution of water, be that confined water or bulk water or interfacial water. So having these signatures that can be very nicely studied by terahertz and subterahertz spectroscopy, of course, one can apply corresponding models, can connect somehow those effects to the biological or maybe medical effects, and then again build models and study the effect one aims to understand, something like that.
Okay, very well. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you.